Good morning. So very aspirational talk by George Halverson. We can see what an integrated delivery system can really do. High performance, continuous improvement through data feedback, committed leadership on continuous improvement, usage of the data for clinical research, usage of the data for driving all sorts of initiatives. And then we step out of that world of the large integrated delivery system. Here in New York, 19.6 million people. That healthcare delivery system is comprised of over 240 hospitals, 1,000 labs, 1,000 pharmacies, 18,000 single doc practices, large fragmentation, 40 health plans, a lot of differences that we have to adjust for and try to overcome. But that vision that Kaiser in the organization that put that in place can be obtained, can be achieved through what George was continuously remarking on, is that integration, that connectivity of data. And that's what the agenda here is in New York, to develop a network, the State Health Information Network of New York, called the SHINY, and from that network be able to integrate the data across the provider system for the benefit of the healthcare system at large, and ultimately be able to achieve many of the same aspirations and same goals in workforce efficiencies, delivery of care, quality outcomes that can be seen in integrated delivery systems such as Kaiser. So with that, I'm going to launch into a few words about how we're working to build this ecosystem here in New York, and I have a few friends. These folks have been working collaboratively both with our organization as well as other organizations across the state in this endeavor. And we're looking forward to explaining to you how this can work as an ecosystem. This cannot be lifted by any one organization. This cannot be accomplished by any one piece of software company. It's going to take an ecosystem to be able to put this together and accomplish what we think we are going to benefit from. So, not to jump in here, obviously it's an extremely evolving world. A lot of transformation is happening. Healthcare reform, a lot has happened because of meaningful use in healthcare IT. We have all of this care delivery churn that's going on. Quality is coming to the table. And that's really creating a lot of opportunity for us to transform the system, transform it using healthcare IT and the tools, much in the same model that we just saw. This is having an enormous ripple effect, and we're really now trying to figure out how to incorporate all of that ripple into it becoming innovation. How do we get all of you all engaged in the different aspects of this ecosystem such that any one motion in this ecosystem has a 10 or 1,000 fold effect across the system. That as innovations happen, they're able to be propagated across the ecosystem such that there's greater benefit. And this isn't one dollar spent with $1 accomplished. It's a dollar spent with $1,000 of outcome from that. We think of this as infrastructure. We think of this as infrastructure that should be, in a few years, as commonplace as electricity. That nobody really wants electricity. People want lights, heat, stereos, the microwave ovens. They want what electricity can accomplish for them. In much the same way that this was really revolutionary back at the turn of the century, where electrification across the country, standard plugs for getting electricity, standard appliance plugs so that you could have an ecosystem of appliances that grew and spawned new industries. That's what we expect from the SHINY, from the healthcare IT system in New York. That this is a basic infrastructure that all New Yorkers should be able to benefit from, and that the things on top of this network, the analogies to toasters, microwave ovens, and stereos, all of those interesting applications that are going to be transformative to the provider community, to the payer community, and to the patient community will come from you all. that everybody out there that is looking at how can they contribute to a transformation of the system and working on an entrepreneurial activity, either as a provider or a software developer or a change in payment reform, the tools that that will benefit you and the things that you'll contribute to the ecosystem will all be hung together because of a common infrastructure. So as we say, just like the wiring the country just significantly increased the standard of living and the transformation of that standard of living, we think that that same is possible by releasing clinical records, the patient records, to obviously in a safe and secure manner, but make that the electricity of this transformation. So a little bit of progress. If you've been to our conference before, we've done a similar talk in previous years, but a little bit of progress. There we go. So as you may know, the SHINE, the State Health Information Network of New York, was originally designed and built and architected largely for clinical use, largely for the purposes of moving patient records around in order to enable the clinical workforce to have access to the records across all those 240 hospitals, 18,000 single doc practices, all those different imaging centers, being able to have that data at the fingertips of the providers such that they would have a much more robust set of information and be able to do that and collaborate with each other in a team-based way, having all of that information ultimately a common care plan, such that team-based activities for care delivery could occur even if not everybody was employed by the same delivery system with the same electronic health record. So that clinical aspect has been the principal role that we've been moving forward, both with the technology as well as with the policies. But increasingly, we're seeing greater and greater demand for and usage of the SHINE for administrative purposes, to start to administer adjudication of claims and other aspects of administration of healthcare delivery such that it increases the efficiency of the workflow, cuts out the fax machine, cuts out the redundant phone calls, cuts out the redundancy in administrative functions. We're seeing increasingly, and you're going to hear great things about this in a few minutes, about the usage of the SHINE for public health, that this network gives public health officials access to those clinical records for case investigations, for emergency purposes, for managing of population health. There are obviously many things that you just heard about from the Kaiser discussion with large population sets of data, how you can analyze that and do tremendous things with regards to contributing resources to public health programs that fit in the right place to affect incredible outcomes. And then the patient itself, of course, we're getting to that later this year. You're going to see demonstration of that here today, and you'll be able to interact with that out on the exhibit floor. But increasingly, that engagement of the patient with their own records and with applications and usages of that data that really cause them to engage with their data, engage with the clinical workforce, engage with the caregivers that are supporting them, and transform their own lives. Lastly, and this is certainly not gone without notice here in New York, is that this is an economic opportunity, and we are looking towards New York being a showcase and a leader of creating that economic opportunity on top of the SHINE. Come build your applications here, come do your healthcare IT work here, because we're investing this as a public infrastructure for the public good, and it is here to support 19.6 million New Yorkers, plus a lot of people from other states that come and go throughout the course of a day. And this is a great economic opportunity to come build an application and be part of the ecosystem. So, as I said, this is not going to be done by any one organization. This isn't going to be done by NICE alone, or a single Rio alone, or a single healthcare provider alone, or the government. This is being done with all of the different constituents working together to contribute to the development of the network, the policies that support the network, that allow for the fluidity of data, and the ecosystem, the financial ecosystem of applications on top of that, the hundreds and hundreds of toasters, microwave ovens, and stereos that will all fit into different places in the delivery system and create transformational results. So how does this work? This is the one geek slide. We'll come back to it a couple of times, but this is the platform that we call the Shiny, the big orange box in the middle there. As we all know, one of the challenges of having a very diverse healthcare delivery system with high fragmentation is 150 EHR vendors, perhaps 20 or 30,000 of those individual instances across the state, and getting that data to actually be in some way, shape, or form available onto a standardized platform such that it could be used by the entire healthcare system. So getting those interfaces built is a significant challenge. We have literally tens of, 20 or 30 engineers across the state on a daily basis building interfaces to unfortunately connect proprietary systems to make the data available through the network. But we're very aggressively working towards that standardization. And New York, with 17 other states, has spent a great deal of time and energy developing technical standards, a technical test tool, and an ability to work on standardization such that these things are plug and play. I'm going to tell you more about that later in the talk, but we're really looking forward to that being a major push in the coming year, is to reduce the cost and the time to connect to get data into the network, whether it's the Shiny, or whether it's a network in Northern Ireland, or whether it's a network in Illinois, that all of these pieces of data are able to commonly plug into your local network and make that data available across the healthcare delivery system. Now, the second key aspect of this network is the geek phrase of API, application programming interfaces. Application programming interfaces have been around in the high-tech sector, of course, for several decades. This is how a software developer programs their piece of software, their application, to interact with the platform that it's living on. Whether that's the Windows environment, or whether that's the Apple environment, or the iPhone, or the Android, in this case, this is the way that you access the data of the Shiny, and the Shiny provides those applications with clinical data from the network to the application, provided the user of the application has been cleared to have access to the data given the policies of the state, largely meaning the patient's control over the data. So those programming in APIs, those are what enables the ecosystem, all of the entrepreneurs across to come build applications against the Shiny. And as we've seen, different applications are being produced that in some cases are providing patients access to the records, in other cases are providing interesting ways of developing care plans, managing diabetes, all of these different kinds of applications that fit into different niches in the care delivery system, the administrative aspects of the healthcare system, public health, and increasingly more and more with patients. This network, of course, is not a single network. New York is a very large state with a lot of diversity. They have 11 different health information exchanges across the state, and these are the backbone of the network. Each of these organizations has been working for the last 5 years to connect up the different providers within their region. They have incredibly dedicated staffs, incredibly dedicated boards of directors that are literally stalwarts in bringing together the community to connect together and share data such that it is a benefit across the community for better healthcare. And each of these organizations has really done a tremendous job in getting the provider community organized, getting the payer community organized, getting all those things connected, and done this largely, got started long before meaningful use, long before the economic opportunities, and they should be commended with what has transpired. We're now in the process of connecting together these 11 individual networks into a network of networks such that it operates as a full statewide network. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a few minutes. A little bit of progress. So we're at 72% of the hospitals in the state are now connected. We are seeing that number reaching up into the 80s in 2014, and quite frankly, there's an element there of where we hit a tipping or a top end point of the remaining hospitals are smaller or of limited delivery, such that we're almost there to say that we've accomplished the hospital systems being connected to the network. Over 50,000 providers now have accounts somewhere in the state. That's out of roughly 65,000 doctors in the entire state, licensed in the state. We have 5.4 million patients who have given affirmative consent to have their records shared. That's 27% of the population, and that number is going up quarter by quarter, a couple more percentage points. So that's allowing for the access of that data, given that's controlled by patients. 34,000 clinical administrative staff. So out of the healthcare workforce that we largely estimate in New York to be around 400,000 workers between administrative and providers, we have a good number of those folks that are now capable of using the network. Here's that in graphical form. You can see that we're closing in on a couple of higher numbers with the FQHCs, but we have a long way to go. That number of 18,000 single doc practices is not small, and that's a lot to connect, particularly if we continue to have to rely on proprietary interfaces. It's a substantial lift if we cannot make those things plug and play. So this network would be a lot of great bells and whistles, bits and bytes, if it did not have public trust. If the public didn't trust it, if the provider community doesn't trust it, then it doesn't allow for safe transport of the data. It would stagnate and not achieve the goals. So what it really needs is the backing of the state in the form of a regulation that defines the rules of the road, that not only help for the standardization of liquidity of data and standardization of the policies such that data can be shared, but also provides that comfort that the regulation is looking after the public good. I'm happy to say that we're really well far along on developing this regulation. It will be largely complete in the next couple of weeks. It's going for final review within the stakeholder community. Obviously, many friends here within this room contributed to the development of that regulation, as well as the review of that regulation to make sure that the Department of Health, in concert and partnership with NICE, got it right. And that it largely embodies the rules of the road necessary to not only share data with extreme trust and the ability to protect patient rights, but also allows for that movement of data to accomplish the healthcare goals. So this regulation will be accompanied by a rather substantial budget request and will be coming forth in the January timeframe. A couple of things, I won't go through this, but a couple of things that you can imagine must be part of this in order to establish that transparency. The QIPA is the word, we pronounce acronyms in the tech sector. The QIPA is the word that everybody is now becoming to have in their lexicon of this is the regulation, this is what is embodying those rules. And it's across the whole gamut here of governance and privacy and security, the technology, the relationships, the allocation, all of that stuff is in there. It's a rather substantial piece of work. I think printed, it's about an inch and a half or 300 or so pages. So if you're looking for an antidote to Ambien, this is a good solution. You also might find that there's a lot in there that could be leveraged in other parts of the country, other countries, and we look forward to sharing that with you all. Okay, so I'm going to jump back into the platform and talk a bit about how we're now trying to maximize the innovation on top of this platform. As you may know, this last year we ran an accelerator program that was done with the Partnership for New York. It was about a $5 million accelerator. We partnered with the VCs in the community, as well as that partnership, in order to create a fund. We did a call for applications for innovation. These were specifically a call for companies to go build applications on top of the Shiny, use the API, and solve healthcare problems that are associated with coordinated care. Coordinated care largely represented by the Medicaid health homes requirements. These new payment systems, this new payment system of Medicaid health home, team-based care, now that they are being paid to work together, how can we give them tools to help them with that care coordination? 250 applicants, 16 different countries, 8 companies were selected. Each of those companies was given $300,000 to get started, they did betas, 17 different pilot betas with the different providers across the state to show how those products could be used and demonstrate how those products could be used in team-based care delivery. We have many graduates in the room today. Those 8 companies ultimately went on to turn those pilots into real revenue. One of the companies recently announced that it was acquired by Avato. Another company, Avato was recently announced it was acquired by WebMD. We also have a company named Curator that drew down a substantial round in funding. And we're gonna talk about a couple of the other companies here on stage with us today. So that was one aspect of us trying to spur more toasters and microwave ovens to build on top of the SHIN-NY. And we'll be running that accelerator again next year. We're putting together that program now. We also have the patient portal. As you may know, we want to make sure that we're stepping forward with being able to provide patients with real access to all of their records. So although we do not have an integrated delivery system here with 19.6 million New Yorkers all accessing the same EHR, we have the ability of aggregating their records together in a single place called the SHIN-NY, and then providing that access to the patients in a secure portal. We ran a requirements gathering with New Yorkers across the state. We then used that requirements gathering to do a call to the design community to come create great designs that would satisfy the requirements and give New Yorkers access to their records in unique ways that really resonate with them. 16 different design firms put up different portal designs. They were put out for public comment and public vote and public sessions. We had 100,000 votes that came in against those different portals and ultimately selected MANAHealth, who we'll see here in a few minutes, to build New York's public portal against the SHIN-NY. Now, this isn't to say that there is only one public access method to get access to your records, but this will be the first, and we encourage lots of other entrepreneurial firms to come use the API and create different patient experiences in different portals. The API is turned loose now, and a sandbox available, so we have that available, and developer forums will start cropping up next year to teach developers how to use the API to accelerate their usage and access to this network and to the data. We have several API partners. We're going to talk about one of those today as well. Different ways, if you can think of mashup, to take the clinical records and the API that's in the SHIN-NY, mash that up with Google Maps API for providing different software application capabilities, perhaps a 3D digital visualization API in order to provide different aspects. So we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. And ultimately, what we hope to get to at some point down the road is an app store where all of these things are aggregated together. But that's a bit down the road. So with that, I'm going to jump into our demonstrations. Our first demonstration will be the patient portal. And as I said, we did that as a crowdsource activity, both on the requirements, having New Yorkers select, design, and determine how they want their patient portal to look. And we're going to now hear from Chris, the CEO from MANAHealth.
So thank you, Dave, very much. So as you mentioned, as we heard earlier this morning, patients want to be connected with their health data. And what the SHIN-NY has done is for the first time, a patient can actually access all of their information in one place. So this has been an incredible opportunity for us to build something and focus on making that information as engaging and as resonating as possible for those patients. And then there's also benefits on the other side to the providers that are seeing those patients, which I'll speak to in a second. So the first thing a patient sees, this is the patient portal, the first thing they see is a set of tiles that have been customized and created to translate their information in a graphical and user-friendly format and make it as available as possible the moment they log into their portal. So these are fully customizable, you can arrange them, and you could also create dashboards, for example, focusing on specific conditions that you may want to monitor. So we'll have a diabetes dashboard, heart health, weight management, or any other dashboard that you can think of, you can create it using this, this format. Now, if you want to dig in deeper, we'll have an analytics view, a deep dive view when you click one of the tiles as well. And that'll let you really dig in and see trending and benchmarking information. Now, this is also important just to see the basic facts of your record, so we've also redesigned and completely reinvented how patients see their basic record information. So as Dave mentioned, it's all unified in one place, and so now we've created a graphical way of seeing that directly into the portal. Now, we didn't want to stop there, so this is only half the story. We've also created inputs so that you can plug in different consumer health devices and other types of devices, such as glucose monitors, or even potentially genetic information through those APIs. So now a patient can see in context the whole of their health, both on the consumer derived data and generated data, patient generated data, as well as the clinical information. And now all of this is really important because now providers, through the SHINee, have a very unique way of counting that patient engagement, and it's called community attribution. So through the SHINee, every single patient that you touch, every facility that touches that patient gets a plus one when they use this portal. And so this is fundamentally different from what's currently existing, where you have to compete for patients, essentially, where no one wins. So the moment a patient logs in, you as a provider can get a plus one. So everyone wins. The patient gets to be engaged and see their data, and the providers also get to count that. And so we have a lot more. This is just a taste. We have it at our booth, so I'd love to show you more. We have a live demo as well tomorrow and at the booth. So please come on over, and I'd love to share more with you. Thank you.
So, Chris, that plus one is regards to meaningful use, correct? So,
yes, correct.
As providers are seeking to get meaningful use, they have a choice of maybe working with their EHR vendor and hanging out their own patient portal, dealing with all of the logins and password resets and all of that stuff that has to do with all the customer or patient-facing aspects of hanging out a patient portal, or they could connect to the SHINee. And this patient portal will satisfy their meaningful use requirements. Is that right?
That's absolutely correct. Yep, that's right. Meaningful use 2, and then we're building it for meaningful use 3, 4, and whatever else they would like to invent. We want it to be as engaging as possible right away.
Fantastic. All right. Now, so, Chris, I think that one of the things that you're really working actively on, obviously, great user interface, great graphical representation of a patient's data, and that's clearly why the design community and New Yorkers selected your company to represent the New York portal and the SHINee. But I think that education and patient engagement go hand in glove. What would you think about having a way of teaching patients about some of the things that's showing up in their record? So perhaps they call up their record and it says that they've got cardiovascular disease and patient can't understand what that might look like. How could you possibly incorporate that into the portal?
So that's a great question. So what we've developed, when you click on a tile or at any point want to access information, we can actually allow you to see information, educational content, visual educational content directly related to what you're trying to investigate. So if you have a tile on heart health and it's your heart rate, you want to know what that means, you can click on it and it'll give you customized educational material right there.
Now, wouldn't it be great if it was a little more interactive? Frank, come on up.
BioDigital uses 3D technology to visualize health information. This is a screen capture of our virtual body platform, the BioDigital Human. It allows you to see inside the body at not just anatomy, but also physiology and living functions like cancer, heart disease, or even something like pregnancy. The first year after release, it was widely adopted in academia as a better way to understand anatomy. And now this year, actually thanks to a grant from Health 2.0 and the NYC EDC, we're bringing it to the provider space to improve patient-doctor communication. So for comparison, this is what just an incredible head and neck surgeon at Memorial Sloan Kettering currently uses to communicate thyroid cancer to his patients. he draws the condition, or in some cases draws on a photo of the patient. This process takes him on average 45 minutes. So for years he's expressed his frustration in using drawings and brochures to communicate such a complex disease. So this year, he'll be using our virtual models in his clinic. This is a screen capture of someone using our iPad application. The patient can step through the anatomy at their own pace, and then the doctor can use it to explain the details of their disease or treatment. And because it's fully cloud-based, it can be easily shared with that patient's family or even attached to their medical record. So while we think this will be an improvement over the current process, ultimately, we want to generate these virtual models from the patient's health record. So the doctor no longer needs to pull up the appropriate view. It's all generated from that patient's data, giving them a personalized model of their health. So here's how one imaging company is beginning to do this. Through our API, they're able to map their scan data into our virtual body. So you can see information previously only understandable by a radiologist, now in the embedded window on the right, is in a format that's much more easily consumed by the patient. So, you know, what if you had a visual representation of your health? If you can see the progression or hopefully regression of a condition, would it impact behavior? Could it empower even those with the lowest health literacy to make better choices? Well, you know, this is why we're really excited to tap into the SHIN-NY, to use this data to drive, to power our visualizations, and then hopefully lower the barriers for people to understand what's happening within their bodies.
So Frank, your company produces an API that does all this great graphical work.
That's exactly right. So our company has a virtual body, but it's all API driven. So we can use the SHIN-NY data, or other people can use our API to map their own information into it.
So all of these entrepreneurs out here that are building applications that now have access to the SHIN-NY API to get clinical information now could also use your API to embed in their product a 3D visualization if that would be useful.
And that's exactly right. That's what Chris and I were talking about. We don't need to be doing it. Someone else could use our API, take their information, use our virtual body.
So you want to make a deal while I move on?
Yeah. We're working on the terms still. We'll figure it out.
All right. Very good. Thanks, Frank.
Thank you.
Okay. So now here's another great innovation. This is one of the companies that was birthed out of the accelerator that we ran this last year. As we all know, one of the bigger issues that we have with the healthcare delivery system and overall healthcare is the ability to reconcile a meds list and help the patient stay on their care plan by taking their meds. This is a company that seeks to solve that problem. ActualMeds and Anne-Marie is going to tell us how they're tapping into the SHIN-NY API to get the relevant medication information from all of the sources that the SHIN-NY has access to, but then frankly doing a better job at providing a list of the medication, something that I think that every provider in this room is going to be really excited about. Anne-Marie?
Thank you, David. So in an effort to address some of the challenges we were hearing about earlier today around coordination and communication of care, particularly with those high risk or chronic disease patients, it's essential to compare what a patient is actually taking with what we think they're taking. And this is critical for a successful transition in care for a high risk patient. So ActualMeds is addressing this problem. As noted, we are pleased and proud to have been a participant in the inaugural accelerator class last year. And as a result of that, we have an interesting use case or story I'll be demonstrating with you on how we're looking at transitions of care and applying medication reconciliation. ActualMeds is providing a solution that's enabling team-based medication reconciliation on demand. Think of it as an app on the data backbone and at the point of care. And this picture shows us the flow of information in a pilot project that we're doing with Hudson Health Plan and Hudson River Healthcare to perform ambulatory medication reconciliation following discharge from an acute care setting. And the goal is prevention of readmissions. Pretty important topic for a lot of us in this room. So ActualMeds seamlessly combines information from a variety of sources. We're developing electronic interfaces to a variety of sources, including the SHIN-NY. We've been already working collaboratively with the team at the SHIN-NY to bring in that data. We are also a certified vendor for the Surescripts acute medication history data feed, and we can turn that feed on for claim and fill information. We can compare that to order information from the SHIN-NY or connectors based on data standards with EHRs so that we can compare the order information from the source where the provider is sitting, information from the SHIN-NY that can provide a much broader perspective across a distributed area, and then claim and fill information so we can also begin to understand what the adherence is. All of that information gets brought together and pre-populates the clinician process of creating that final validated or curated list of actual medications. And at the point of validation, we look at that list and our system automatically risk assesses it and does analytics and guidance for quality measures against that data. Here's what this looks like. This is a snapshot of data coming into the system from a variety of sources. In this case, we show a simulated stream of data from the SHIN-NY compared to claim data, and we see the beginning of the process of a clinician building that curated list. That's what you see in that blue column. And all of the information allows us to have a nice visual heuristic across all of the sources to understand what's really happening with that patient. And the automatic risk assessment is reflected as a score, a weighted averaged aggregate score, and we can compare and understand the risks based on all of those different sources and inputs to the process. And importantly, the medication reconciliation process also begins to enable the provider to develop and note those process measures, and we are moving towards certification for meaningful use around medication reconciliation. So we'll be ONC certified in the new year. But once we've reconciled and created that final list, what do we do with it? So we provide support in the form of risk assessment and real-time application of quality measures. Here you see items that have been flagged with star measures that are meaningful to a health plan and also correspond to many of the HEDIS and other quality measures, so we can guide decision-making at point of care and then close the loop by documenting an action plan that can then seamlessly fit into coordination of care. So what do we have here? Think of us as an app on that SHIN-NY data platform, on-demand medication reconciliation. We can consume their data. We could potentially send back at some point in the future a final reconciled list. So we can provide that complete reconciled data list, we can provide context, and we can create a framework for organizing and coordinating that into the process of care.
Fantastic. So let me see if I get this right. Every time I've ever gone to a doctor and they start through the medical history, one of the first things they ask me is, what medications are you taking, right? And then we have this dialogue back and forth of trying to reconcile that list. So what you're telling us is that your application pulls what it knows from all the different data sources, has that dialogue with the patient in an interactive way, and then possibly has the best source of information on what the patient is taking because it's gone through that Q&A session with the patient.
Right.
So you then could possibly give back the SHIN-NY a reconciled meds list that's going to be more accurate than anything else that the provider community would have access to. Does anybody want that? Well done. All right, let's jump out of the patient-provider space for a little bit and let's talk about public health. As many of the communities are starting to now use, public health officials around the state are starting to use the SHIN-NY to be more efficient in how they do their jobs. Broome County is certainly one of the counties that's leading the way with the Southern Tier Health Link, or STEEL, Rio, and we'd love to hear how that all works. Claudia?
Thank you very much, David. And it's a pleasure to be able to share what's been going on in our county with all of you. I'm going to talk a little bit about public health work and something that affects you or may be impacting your life, although you may not realize it immediately. It is our role, and it's mandated in law, to really talk about, to really investigate communicable diseases. And communicable diseases are occurring in New York State. We have 115,000 communicable disease reports a year. And in Broome County, we average about 350 to 500 communicable disease reports. So this is by no means an easy task. We also get into confirming diagnosis and treatment for sexually transmitted diseases, TB, and using the SHINee and being connected to the HIE through STEEL has reduced our investigation time, improved our state reporting, and actually has saved us money. So we talk a little bit about a disease report. There are a class of diseases that we need to report within 48 to 72 hours. So right away, expediency is the biggest issue. We need to rapidly identify what is going on with the patient. We need to know things like what was the date of onset of symptoms. We have various clinical tests that we need to know. Was there a consultation with an infectious disease specialist? And we can do all of that through the SHINee. Once we obtain that information, then we can have our case definition and we begin to interview contacts. Everyone, for example, who was within that time period of the onset of symptoms and within perhaps a 6 feet range. If you think about this room, how many people are you within 6 feet? It becomes a daunting task. So this is what an example of our HIE, SHINee provides for us. We can go in and we see the facility right away. We can see a multitude of tests. We can see various reports. We have EMR reports. We have doctor's notes. And all of this, as I said, is important to glean that necessary information so that we can move forward. Just a couple of more views here that show you what is possible. And vital signs becomes one of the most important things in doing communicable diseases and confirming that, in fact, you do have a specific type of disease. We talk about TB testing. I picked this area because, again, expediency is necessary. We have about 2,100 cases that we see, actually visits that we see a year. But more importantly, for this particular patient, we need to know what type of pharmaceutical cocktail we're actually going to be giving them, and that very much depends on liver function, on pre-existing medical conditions, and we get that information, again, going directly to the SHINee. So here we go. We not only get the radiology reports, we know where they're coming from, we know the date, this is a matter of compliance, and we have to move quickly because these patients need to be treated. Again, they are communicable, highly communicable to those that they live with primarily. Going to move a little further. This shows you some other things that confirmatory tests that we get. So we costed this out and we said, what do we look like when we have to deal with faxes, phone calls, hard copy versus using the SHINee? And this is an extremely conservative estimate of 90,000 a year just for these two areas. And this figure actually doubles when we have a full-blown outbreak investigation going on or we have a full TB cluster going on where we would have needed to bring in additional staff to do our investigations and to weed through volumes of hard copy medical information to get the job done. Also, this does not include the time that it takes from the inpatient and hospital staff to pull these records, make these copies, send them in faxes to us. So it's really amazing what the SHINee has done. I view the SHINee now as a public health partner. I can't imagine doing our work without that.
And this is Broome County with roughly 3,000 or 300,000 folks in the county?
We're about 200,000 right now.
200,000. So now take those numbers and extrapolate them into New York Metro of roughly 10, 12 million people. Obviously a lot of cost-saving opportunity for public health.
Yeah, tremendous. And every health department in the entire state, there are 57, including New York City, have to do this under public health law. So I will be selling this to my peers next month in January. how important this is, and hopefully they'll get on board.
Now, do you think that there's a opportunity for an entrepreneurial company to build a piece of software that taps into the API that would be custom purposed for your use?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we also serve patients, so they want to know what's happening in their lives. They want to know their test results as well. So health departments have a dual role. I just would like to add one thing before I leave, emergency preparedness, and I know the next person speaking will be covering that. We have had terrible floods, disasters like Sandy, and in sheltering 125 special needs patients, we were able to preserve life and reduce morbidity because we had access to the HIE. We knew what meds they needed, we knew their doctors, we knew what their medical issues were. This is a crucial component in years to come.
Fantastic, thank you. All right, so our last speaker presenter here has a very unique role and has survived a couple of enormous disasters and is looking forward to having the capabilities of the SHIN-NY to support him in the near future. Mordy?
I would love these capabilities. My name is Mordy Goldfeder. I work for the New York City Office of Emergency Management. And in a nutshell, I'm a health and medical planner, and my job is to prepare for your worst disaster, or for New York City's worst disaster and our region. So I don't know if you recall, about a year ago, a storm came into town. Sandy, anyone live through it? So during Sandy, one of my responsibilities was helping to coordinate the evacuation of medical facilities after the storm. We evacuated 32 healthcare facilities after the storm. I'm gonna tell you a story about one of those facilities. This facility is right near the beach. They were prepared. They moved their patients up to the second and third floors. They brought in extra supplies. They brought them up to the second floor. Their medication, they printed out from their EMRs charts on paper so that they had them on the second floor. Well, during the disaster, I get a call from the director of nursing just in the middle of Sandy when it was rolling in that they're now evacuating to the third floor because water was coming in the second floor window. All their supplies destroyed, medication gone, and of course, their paper charts they printed out gone. IT systems were in the basement, destroyed. We evacuated those patients, some of them to shelters. Now you're talking about vulnerable population in a shelter. Those shelters were staffed by doctors that we brought in from across the country through the help of our federal partners. Doctors who don't necessarily see this type of patient. Now they had no clue where to begin. They don't know what type of meds they're on, what type of illnesses they have, and having access to this in the shelter system would have helped tremendously.
That's fantastic. So in the future, having access to the SHIN-NY such that any provider, when they see a patient for the first time, isn't starting with a blank face and a blank screen, they have all of that relevant recent history with them.
Absolutely, the continuity of care is most important.
So how about all of the calls that the emergency responders received during the course of the storm? They're watching these news reports coming in saying that the facility that their parent or loved one in is shutting down because it's full of water, and they have fear and worry about where this loved one is now going. And of course, there's no way to get in touch with them because communications are down. The best they can do is rely upon you and the emergency staffs that communicate with you. What would be helpful here?
So, for the first facilities that evacuate, you know, we get their information. You know, we can give it to our 311 system. The benefit of this would really come to play, and I'll tell you, you know, Mother Nature wasn't finished with us after Sandy. For those who recall, a few days later, we had a nor'easter that came in. And we had four more facilities that were already fragile, and we evacuated those facilities. So now you had patients in those facilities that were already evacuated, now being evacuated for the second time. And now they were going to all different facilities. People, it was just one of those most difficult things to track. But if we had the system, we would be able to pull up their name, find out where they're from, and get all the information we need to find these patients.
Fantastic. And loved ones be able to find their emergency responders, be able to find loved ones, and perhaps someday maybe even loved ones be able to log onto the network and see where their parents are. Fantastic. Thank you, Mordy. So with that, you can see many different applications and usages of the network of the SHIN-NY that are already starting to emerge, others that are coming in the coming year. And literally, we think of this as just the tip of the iceberg, that this is just a couple of examples, and we've built this as an ecosystem such that the hundreds, if not thousands, of different opportunities to improve the clinical workforce, to improve the delivery of healthcare through administrative and workflow redesign, to improve public health and access, all of these things are possible by the entrepreneurial community in this room and in countless other environments that can come to New York and build here. And we're really looking forward to you taking advantage of this, learning and rubbing shoulders with the rest of the folks in this room throughout the course of the next couple of days. Go get immersed on the show floor and find mashups that are really going to enable your business, but more importantly, transform healthcare. Thank you. So we have a few minutes, we can take a few questions. Do we want to have the lights up?
Hi, I'm Evan Shore from Metadata. I was wondering how patient permissioning works. So you said patients control access to their own data to whoever needs it. So I was wondering how that process works. And then the second question is, if you're aggregating data from disparate sources that all have it in different formats, how do you normalize that data?
Well, I'm not going to answer the second question in any detail because that's a long process. But obviously, all of the different proprietary systems bringing that data into the platform, there are different normalization techniques for different pieces of the data, but then being able to serve it out. We're looking, largely there's a coalescence in the developer community around this continuity of care document as the method of exchange of information, and that's largely what we're using as the container. That doesn't mean that all of the data inside of that container is the same when shared, but increasingly year to year that will grow in strength. With regards to your first question, I think that the different data sources hold challenges in bringing them together. But the patient ultimately has access through this platform by providing consent down to the granularity of the provider or institution level. So in the state of New York, the policy is that the patient has control of their data, that it's not shared with the provider unless the patient gives explicit access. And that's done through the RIOs and through the provider participants of those RIOs who receive a consent. So the network holds the data. As soon as the provider has access control given to them by the patient, they have free flow and access to the data.
And is that done through paper? They sign it, or is it?
In some cases, it's paper. In other cases, it's fully electronic. It depends on the provider.
Thanks.
Over here. Hey, Ken.
Hey, Dave. This is truly exciting. I'm Ken Ong from New York Hospital, Queens. My question is about the New York patient portal, which I think we all find very exciting. So a lot of us have this challenge now where our patients have to go into our hospital patient portal or our clinic or outpatient patient portals, as well as their private physician portals to see what's going on in their healthcare in one, two, three, or four, maybe even more different locations. So the prospect of a statewide patient portal is truly exciting. My question is, though, will this be ready in time for any of us to use it to attest to stage two of meaningful use?
What do you think, Chris?
Yes. No, we're working around the clock. In fact, most of my team is programming right now. We're working 6-7 days a week, testing continuously. And we're aiming for a first quarter next year release. So we're being very aggressive with our times.
Great, thank you.
Over here.
Dave, Peter MacIsaac. Although I'm a physician, I'm also deeply involved in health IT standards and communication. You alluded to the state approach to creating, you used the word creating standards for how to do this, but how are you going with that? And also, how does that relate to years and years of work done by groups like IHE and HL7. How does the state approach really fit in with that, use it, or is it in fact trying to duplicate or replicate?
Yeah, great question. So it does leverage the HL7 and IHE profiles. What we know from those profiles is that they were incomplete with regards to forcing a level of standardization that would allow for direct plug-and-play compatibility of systems. So there was still enough optionality such that engineers could create interfaces that were not quite interoperable with each other because there was still enough variation in those interfaces. These standards that were created with 19 other states and 30 different vendors from both the EHR and HIE community remove the optionality, create tight standardization such that the interfaces are plug and play. We have a test tool that's under development, and that test tool will actually be done in Q1 such that a software vendor can test against that test tool and know whether or not their product will be plug and play. What we really need now is the purchasing community of the providers to really demand interoperability that meets these standards from the 19 states and beyond, such that the vendor community hears loudly and clearly from their customer base that this is of utmost importance, such that we can get to a greater scale across the healthcare system. Okay, I think we've got time for one more.
Oh yeah, quick one. On ActualMeds, since a medication reconciliation at discharge from hospital or from the ER is so time consuming, I was wondering if they've piloted this or they're using this in hospitals at all.
Not yet inpatient. Right now, most of our focus has been on the post-discharge ambulatory settings, but that's something we're very interested in because it needs to happen around the full continuum of care. We have a little slide that we didn't have time for, but if you come by table 35, we show sort of where we can begin to plug in and where some of our use cases are. So not yet, but hopefully in the future.
Very good. So that concludes our presentation for this morning. Obviously, everybody will be around later for questions, but I'd like to thank the panel here for all their hard work and participation.